Numbers 23 and 19 says, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. If he said it, he's going to do it. Come on, Shabbat. So hold fast to your faith. Say he's gonna do it. Come on, everybody, say he's gonna do it. Everybody else. Say, wait. It will surely come. Don't be anxious for in everything. He has an appointed time.
Good morning, good morning. Come on in. We're so excited about our worship encounter this morning. Listen, let's go ahead and like, share, and tag as many people as you possibly can. There is a life-changing word going forth this morning brought by our lead pastor, Bishop Jonathan Elwood Sr., and I'm telling you, you want to be a part of this word. So let's go ahead, tag, let's share, and let's get ready to worship.
Turned into wine.
Come on, say, open the eyes of the blind.
Open the eyes of the blind.
Hey,
there's no one like you.
That's good. That's none like you.
None like you.
Come on, say, into the darkness you shine.
Into the darkness you shine.
And say, out of the ashes.
Out of the ashes we rise.
There's no one
no
like you.
I'm not afraid.
prophesy that.
I believe.
Yeah.
I see you do it again.
Yeah.
You made a way.
Come on, put pressure right there.
There was no way.
Yeah.
And I believe.
I seen you do it.
I seen you do it.
I seen you move. Come on, let's prophesy that this morning. And we believe,
I believe
that you're going to do it again.
I see you do it again.
He did it.
You made a way.
Well, there was no way.
There was no way.
I believe.
I believe.
I seen you.
I seen you do it again.
Wow, listen, the way this service is going thus far, this is the right time to take time out to sow a seed. Listen, I don't care what size the seed is, but this is the time to sow this seed. It's harvest time, and there's a word that's coming forth, and you don't want to miss having seed in the ground. So listen, we have multiple ways that you can sow. You can sow by text to give. That number is 205-632-1129, or you can download our ANC Fairfield app. There's a giving tab and you can follow the prompts. But let's sow and let's do it now. And let's get ready to see what God has in store for us.
Thank you, Jesus. 'Cause he is my faithful Father, calling me out of the dark. And I cannot whisper away what he said in the light. 'Cause he is my firm foundation, and my anchor won't be moved. And storms may collide, but my soul is on fire with his words. Thank you, Lord. 'Cause we listen to the sound of power on my lips. 'Cause Jesus has broken the curse, and he has never lost a battle. 'Cause who are you, great mountain, that you should not bow low? 'Cause Jesus defeated never lost a battle. Yes, Lord. Had he never will, he never will. Come on, you say it, he never will right here.
Had he never will, he never will.
Yeah, come on, say it, never will.
Had he never will, he never will.
Say it right here. So he is my faithful.
He is my faithful.
Whisper. should not bow, though. Cause Jesus defeated the darkness. Cause Jesus defeated the darkness. Cause Jesus defeated the darkness. Hey, cause Jesus defeated the darkness. Can we say right here that Jesus defeated the darkness? Jesus defeated the darkness. Hey, he defeated the darkness.
Jesus defeated the darkness.
Jesus defeated.
Jesus defeated the darkness.
He has.
He has never lost
a battle. A battle. Had he never will, he never will. Had he never will, he never. He never will, he never will. If you believe that, come on, give him praise. If you serve a God that is a God that is a champion.
It's Sunday morning, everybody, and I'm excited to be in the house of God. Welcome, my ANC family, to our virtual service and all of our visiting friends. If you haven't done it already, I want you to go down to the bottom of the screen, tap the share button, share this service on your personal page, and tag some names in the chat of people that you know need to be in the house of the Lord today. I'm excited about this word that I have to share with you today. Will you lift your hands with me as we worship the Lord? Only believe, only believe, all things are possible if you only believe, only believe. Whoa, whoa, only believe. All things are possible if you own. Believe. Will you lift your hands half-mast and say this with me? Always remember Jesus, Jesus. Always remember Jesus, Jesus. Always keep him on your mind. One last time, everybody, open your mouth and sing with me now. Always remember, say Jesus. Jesus, always remember Jesus, Jesus, always keep him on your mind. Clap your hands and give our God some praise. Our scripture text this morning is found in the book of St. Matthew, chapter number 12. We're going to read verse number 43 through verse number 45. The Bible says, when the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest, and findeth none. Then he saith, I will return into my house from whence I came out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept, and garnished. Then goeth he, and taketh with himself seven other spirits more wicked than himself. And they enter in and dwell there,
And the last state of that man is worse than the first. Even so shall it be also unto this wicked generation. So far, the scripture. Today, I want to talk to you from this simple subject, protect your freedom. Protect your freedom. It is God's will, ladies and gentlemen, that we as his creation walk liberated and walk free from the bondages of sin and the shackles of the enemy. From the beginning of time, God created humanity to walk in fellowship with him, and he created us so that we would be dominators instead of being dominated. Through the fall of Adam, through his sin in the garden, Adam being the father of all creation, man were made sinners through the fall of Adam. And as a result, we were born with an Adamic nature, a nature that has the tendency to fall into sinful and harmful behavior. Not only is it a fallen nature and a sinful nature, but it is a nature that is sensitive to the influential voice of the devil. Please understand this, ladies and gentlemen, whether you know it or not, the devil is real. Demons are real. The devil, who is Lucifer, according to the book of Isaiah, the archangel, he is also referred to as Beelzebub, the prince of the devils, used to be the archangel or the anointed cherub who covereth. He was chosen and created by God to create worship, to lead the worship in heaven. He was the captain of the heavenly host as it relates to those that were created to worship God. He was not just one who created music. He was not just one who made music. But Lucifer, ladies and gentlemen, he was music. Music came out of his loins. Music played as he walked. He was the most beautiful angel that God ever created. We understand that because of his beauty, he got lifted up in pride. He said to himself, I will exalt myself like unto the Most High God. I'm going to have my own throne, and I'm going to create or influence angels that were created to worship God to worship me. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, the first sin was not Adam and Eve's disobedience to the commandment of the Lord not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But ladies and gentlemen, the first sin in the history of the stratosphere, in the history of the heavens and the earth, was the sin of pride. It was when Lucifer decided he would start a revolt in heaven, and you know, he started a fight that he could not finish. The Bible says through the mouth of Jesus, I beheld Satan as lightning falling from heaven. God did not even get off the throne. He said within himself, I'm too busy for this little peon. Michael, please handle Satan. And Michael kicked him out of heaven. Lucifer came to earth, possessed the serpent in the garden, and the serpent beguiled Eve, who enticed her husband to disobey God. Hence, we find the complicated narrative that we deal with today as it relates to the battle of the flesh against the spirit. I need you to understand this, ladies and gentlemen, that although we are in a fight, God wants us to be free. God wants us to be individuals who understand our purpose, who understand the authority that we possess. He told the people in St. John chapter number 10 and verse number 10, "The thief cometh but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy." He said, "But I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly." Now, ladies and gentlemen, when I am bound, I may be alive physically, but I'm dead spiritually. And let me just help you today to understand that there is no real life outside of spiritual life. This is why, ladies and gentlemen, we have gone through years and years of temptation, years and years of warfare, years and years of tussling with the enemy. So, conclusively speaking, I want you to understand that the devil is real. Demons are real. Demons are simply angels that fell from glory because of their propensity and their ability to follow Lucifer, the archangel. He was so clever, ladies and gentlemen, that he was able to influence a third of the heavenly host of angels to follow him and turn away from following God. Oh, hence we find Revelation. If, in fact, it is difficult for angels who have seen him, who have beheld him, the Ancient of Days, Jehovah, oh my God, Elohim, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the beautiful God, the creator of the entire world. If it is difficult for angels to follow him that have been in his very presence, then we mere men who have never seen him, we will be challenged with our ability to follow him. And so, ladies and gentlemen, hence we find in the pericope, in the text, Jesus talking to us about demons in Matthew chapter number 12. Now, I want you to study the entire chapter of Matthew chapter number 12, because Jesus is going through a lot of contention with the Pharisees in this particular chapter. He starts off by arguing with them regarding his disciples not washing their hands when they ate. Trivial matters. Religious people trip over trivial matters. They argue weeks and months about whether or not Kirk Franklin should have cussed. I don't have time to deal with that. Religious people get stuck on things that are not efficacious to spirituality. But people who are spiritual, they're more concerned about things that really matter. Jesus had to argue with them concerning that. Then there was a man in the synagogue who had a withered hand, same chapter. And the Pharisees saw his condition, and they automatically began to watch Jesus to see if he would heal the man. Well, the Bible tells us that when Jesus looked at them, he asked them a question. Is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath? Oh, my God. And he began to upbraid them because of their hypocrisy, because they wanted to find a reason to indict him. They wanted to find accusation against him. And the only thing they could come up with was he's doing work on a day we're not supposed to work. And they equated his ability to heal as work. The Bible says Jesus healed the man with the withered hand. My God. Not only that, the Bible says another man appears. He has a spirit. He has a spirit that has him blind. And he has a spirit that has him dumb. He can't see and he cannot speak. And it is because of a spirit. Here in the text, ladies and gentlemen, we see now that not all sickness is physical. Oh, I feel like preaching, Billy. Not all sickness is physical. There is something called the spirit of infirmity. And so the Bible doesn't say that Jesus healed him. The Bible says that Jesus cast out that spirit that had this man bound up. He cast out that spirit that had this man bound up. And when he cast out that spirit, the Bible says that the blind saw and the dumb began to speak. The scripture says that the Pharisees began to talk about him. They began to criticize him. They said, well, the only reason why he's able to cast out devils is because he's Beelzebub. He's the chief devil. And so he can cause the little devils to be cast out because he's the chief devil. In other words, he's the big devil telling the little devils to come out of people. And Jesus looked at them strange and said, are y'all crazy? A house divided against itself cannot stand. And a kingdom divided against itself will be destroyed. Jesus was saying Satan would never fight his own agenda. And I come to tell you that it is sad to say, but sometimes there's more unity in the kingdom of darkness than there is in the kingdom of light. Billy, can I talk? There's more unity, Demetrius, in the kingdom of darkness. Satan never has conflict with his demons because everybody is in agreement that they want to kill, steal, and destroy. But in the body of Christ, we're trying to build. We're trying to edify. We're trying to help. We're trying to usher people in to a better life. But it seems like we can't get along. Oh, the devil is a liar. Now, when Jesus goes on this tangent about that Satan would not cast out his own followers, and he talks about a house divided against itself cannot stand, Jesus decides in verse number 43 to give the people a crash course on demonic spirits. He says, let me teach y'all about demonic possession. And now I want to deal with this paradigm called demonic possession, because there are many people who do not understand the difference between the activity of the flesh and the activity of demons. Now, please understand this, that Satan tries to mimic God. In other words, whenever God wants to do something great in the earth, he looks for a man that he can get in and use. When the enemy wants to do something terrible in the earth, he looks for a man that he can get in and use. In other words, God and Satan have an agenda in the earth, and they both are looking for the same thing, and that is a body. Oh God, I feel like talking here. And so we understand that Satan works through the flesh in order to orchestrate his agenda. But God works through the Spirit, usurping the authority of the flesh in order to orchestrate his agenda. God does not use your flesh. God kills your flesh and puts your spirit in charge. The enemy tries to kill your spirit and put your flesh in charge. And you will know that you are possessed with a spirit when you will begin to operate in activity of the flesh that is beyond your ability to put in check. Oh God. Now notice he says, when in verse number 43, the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places seeking rest and findeth none. I got five things I'm going to lift up from this text and we're going home. Number one is freedom comes when the devil leaves. Notice he says, when the unclean spirit is gone out of a man. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I must reiterate to you that an unclean spirit is nothing more than a fallen angel that has submitted to the leadership of Lucifer, the archangel. These spirits get in men. Now, the unclean spirit, when it is gone out of a man, that means it has been cast out. The spirits of the devil need a body in order to have rest. Now, I want you to understand, ladies and gentlemen, that a lot of people are bound because they have an unclean spirit in them. The Bible says through the mouth of the Apostle Paul that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against powers, against principalities, against the rulers of darkness, against spiritual wickedness in high places. He says when there's an unclean spirit there, let me unpack that. An unclean spirit can produce emotions and feelings within you that are inconsistent with the will of God. There, the unclean spirit can cause you to operate in wrath, explosive anger. Unclean spirits can give you a spirit of whoredom where you are promiscuous with many, many sexual partners, never being satisfied and having no limitations to your sexual appetite. That is an unclean spirit, a lust spirit working in you. Unclean spirit can produce depression. Causing you to be very, very dark, in a dark and dismal place. Now, I've got to go on further because there's so much I've got to unpack this morning. But he says, when the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places. Let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. Freedom comes when the devil leaves. When the devil leaves, you get your control back. When the devil leaves, you get your discipline back. When the devil leaves, joy is replaced with sorrow. Or sorrow is replaced with joy. When the devil leaves, there's a calmness and a peace that will come over you that will get rid of the anger that you're dealing with. When the devil leaves, you will have control over your flesh. When the devil leaves, you will put down that drug and that alcohol, those drugs and that alcohol, and you will be able to be sober and in your right mind. Anything that has been controlling you, anything that has been manipulating you, anything that has had you locked up in bondage, when the devil leaves, your freedom will come. And God says he only wants you to be submitted to him. The devil wants to make you his slave, but God wants to make you his servant. Oh God, I feel like preaching here. And so the Bible says, hallelujah, when the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places seeking rest and findeth none. Number two, when I gain my freedom, the devil loses his peace. Now, because the devil, I've already told you, he needs a body. He needs a body. And whenever he's kicked out of his body, he does not have peace. He does not have rest. Peter said he goeth about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. As long as he's on the outside of a body, he is unhappy. He is angry. He is irritated. He is frustrated. Whenever you kick the devil out and you let God in, you make the devil mad. And I want you to know, some of you right now, you got spirits walking around through dry places looking for somewhere to live because you let them know they can no longer live in your house. Can I preach in this place here? And the Bible begins to tell us here that they're finding rest. He's walking through places where there is no water, places where there is no moisture, and he's seeking rest, and he can't find anywhere to go. You got to be careful with this. Now, as we go on in verse number 44, the Bible says, then he saith, I will return into my house from whence I came out. Now, number three is this: failure to replace my bondage will lead to short-lived freedom. I want you to notice in verse number 44, he says, I will return to my house. Somebody type house in the chat. Now, understand this, ladies and gentlemen, that there is a hint of arrogance, because when the enemy has used you, maybe he's used you in pride. Maybe he's used you in drugs and alcohol. Maybe he's used you in homosexuality and lesbianism, or perhaps adultery and fornication. Maybe he's used you to be a liar and a manipulator and a deceiver. And now God has delivered you. Now, the enemy thinks he owns you because you loaned him some of your time. So in his arrogance, he'll say, I'm going back to my house. Whenever you talk about going to your house, that means you got keys. But I come to tell you, the devil does not have keys to your house, because he does not have the deeds to your soul. Can I preach in here? And I need you to understand this here. Now, I want to go deeper with this, because notice he says, I will return into my house. Now, you must understand, ladies and gentlemen, that you are not a room. You are a house. I just dropped a bomb, Demetrius. I hope the people catch it. You are not a room. You are a house. I've never heard of a one-room house. I've never heard of a house that only has one area. A house has many rooms. Now, what are you saying, preacher? It is possible for you to be saved, but for you to have an evil spirit. Because if the devil does not own the whole house, maybe he's living in a room in the house. Can I preach, Billy? I need you to understand this, ladies and gentlemen. You are a house. Somebody type, I'm a house. That means I've got a living room. That means I got a dining room. That means I have a bedroom. That means I have a den. That means I've got different areas. And the problem with so many believers is that we've got God in the dining room. We've got God in the kitchen. We've even got God in the master bedroom. But we haven't let him move into the guest bedroom. And because we don't have God in the guest bedroom, it gave the enemy somewhere to sleep. That's why I can praise God on Sunday, but be fighting Sunday night. That's why I can pray Monday morning and Monday evening, be somewhere I'm not supposed to be. It doesn't mean I'm not saved, but it means that I need to be delivered. And sometimes you can be saved, but lack in deliverance. And God says, I don't just want to have a piece of you. I want all of you. Somebody ought to type in the chat, Lord, fill my house. Oh, what does that mean? Now, I want you to look at in verse number 44, because the Bible says, he says, I'll return into my house from whence I came out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept and garnished. Then goeth he. Number four, I want to say this. My freedom will always be threatened by my previous bondage. My freedom will always be threatened by my previous bondage. I want you to notice in verse number 45, in verse number 44, the Bible says in the B clause, hallelujah, hallelujah, it says, when he is come, he findeth it swept and garnished. I want to look at the words, when he is come. Many times the enemy comes and we don't recognize him. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, whenever I recommit myself to the Lord and I get delivered from evil spirits, we don't recognize when the enemy is come and knocking again. See, you got to understand that just because you shouted the victory and just because you got delivered, that doesn't mean that you have free clearance to not be aware of the enemy. Your freedom is always being threatened because the enemy is not happy with your freedom. So the Bible says, although he left, he is coming back. Somebody ought to type it in the chat and say, he's coming back. You got to understand that Satan is always trying to be like Jesus. Jesus is coming back too. So he figured he would come back. Whenever he has to leave you alone, there will be times, let me work it just a little bit, son. There will be times where he will come back thinking that he can get back in. But you've got to understand here, when he comes back, he doesn't need to find your house empty, swept, and garnished. Now, ladies and gentlemen, number four is this. Failure to replace my bondage will lead to short-lived freedom. Now, I've got to move on here because there is no way that we are supposed to get delivered and set free and not replace our bondage with something else. So many people get excited about being free. They forget to get filled. See, you don't need to be an empty house. You need to be a full house, and you need to have the right stuff living in your house. Let me tell you what happens when God delivers you. You got to do what happened in Acts 2, 1 through 3. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one place with one accord, and suddenly There came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. I want to pause in verse number 3, because the Bible says, in verse number 2 rather, because the Bible says that when the Holy Ghost came, it filled all the house. Can I suggest to you, ladies and gentlemen, that when I have a full house, I don't have room for the devil to come in. The problem is in the text is that the Bible says when he comes back, he finds that I'm still empty. I'm no longer bound, but I'm still empty. I may as well have a little church meatball, because I understand something here, that God is saying to us, it's time to get full. If you don't want to go back to where you came from, you've got to get full. If you don't want to slip back into the lifestyle that he delivered you from, you've got to get full. And you don't need to get full of mess. You don't need to get full of things, but you need to get full of the Holy Ghost. The Bible says the whole house was filled. It filled all the house where they were sitting. I dare you to lift your hands and shout, Lord, fill my house. I don't want the devil to have any room in my life. Lord, fill my house. Yes, I feel like preaching here. The Bible says here in verse number 45, then goeth he. What the devil does is, according to verse number 44, it says he cometh to check you out. He starts tampering with you. And when he sees that you're responding to some of his impulses, when he sees that he can probe you and you have a response that you used to have, he says, okay, the door is open. The Bible says in verse number 45, then goeth he. He says, because now I want to make sure that when I get back in the house, I'll never have to leave again. I want to take their freedom from them. I want to take their peace from them. I want to take their joy from them. So he goes and gets 7 other buddies that are more wicked than himself. And they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first state. This is number 5. And I got to go. Number 5 is, if I don't protect my freedom, I run the risk of being worse than ever. Can I preach here? I need you to understand, the devil can never come back if you learn how to protect your freedom. You may say, how do I protect my freedom? I'm going to tell you how. It's found in James 4:7. The Bible says, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee. I need to preach to you and tell you that if you want to stay free, you got to fight for your freedom. When the devil shows up, you got to remember how hard it was when you were bound. You have to remember how much you suffered when you were bound. You got to remember how sad you were when you were bound. You have to remember how much money you spent when you were bound. And you have to tell the devil, I don't have time for your game. I'm in a new season. I'm in a new day. Yeah, devil, you used to live here. Yeah, devil, you used to be in my house. But I want you to know, when God delivered me, I changed the locks. I changed the locks. I got Jesus on the lock. And unless you say his name, you can't enter in. Somebody ought to type it in the chat. I'm fighting for my freedom. I'm fighting for my deliverance. I believe that 2021 is my year. I believe that 2021 is my season. But I gotta fight. I know the devil is not gonna give up easy. But I'm not afraid. When he shows up, I'll tell the devil, I resist you. I refuse you. My destiny is too great. My anointing is too precious. My future is too bright. Lord, I gotta fight. Lord, I'm gonna fight. I need 150 people watching me to type fight. I can't let that man come back. Fight. I can't let that woman come back. Fight. Depression, you can't ever come back. I've gotta fight. Fear, you've got to get out of here. Alcohol abuse, you've got to go. Anger, you can never come back. I've been redeemed. I've been bought with a price. And whom the Son has set free, it's truly free indeed. Can you say yeah? Can you say yeah? Hey! Hey! Yeah! 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 Somebody type in the chat, I'm protecting my freedom. I'm protecting my freedom. I'm protecting my future. I'm protecting my peace. I'm protecting my life. Yeah, 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 yeah. Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him the glory. Give him the honor. Right in your house. I dare you to jump on your feet and start praising God. I'm free from the shackles. I'm free from the chains. I'm free from the bondage. I'm free from the fear. I'm leaving the past behind. Hello, hello. Glory to God. Glory to God. I got too much to live for. I got too much to live for. Ah, yeah. Somebody type, I'm free. I'm free. Praise the Lord. I'm free. I want you to be encouraged today that God is getting ready to move in your life, in your finances, in your character, in your business, in your marriage, even in your children. Freedom has come. No more bondage, no more shame. Hallelujah. No more pressure, no more weights. Hallelujah. Whom the Son has set free is truly free indeed. Will you lift your hands and worship with me? You've been in this place long enough, and your mountainside has been rough. The struggle is over for you. Come on, help me sing that. You've been in this place long enough, and your inside has been rough. The struggle is over for you. Come on, let's make it personal and we're going home. I've been in this place long enough, and my mountainside has been rough. The struggle is over for me. This is your day. This is your time. And the Lord says, if you can believe Him, even now, you will walk in your freedom. God bless you and God keep you, is my prayer. Hallelujah, Jesus.
What a life-changing word from our lead pastor. Man, I'm sure it blessed your soul. Listen, if you're deciding today that you want to be a part of this great ministry, all you have to do is follow the information that's been posted on the screen. Or maybe you're deciding today that you need Jesus as the head of your life. All you have to do is type in the word salvation in the comment box, and one of our virtual altar workers will connect with you. We're praying for you, and we're believing God that this is going to be an amazing year for you. Be blessed and have an amazing week.
As we